It's time to worship God. So welcome to Happy Hour at the world-famous Salvation Saloon's Water and Home Church. Get ready to be blessed. So sit back, hang on, and enjoy the ride as we take you out of this crazy world and into a spirit-filled, life-changing gospel show service. Already in progress.
Look at there. Look at all these bright, shiny faces here. The Salvation Saloon, Water and Hole Church, I'll tell you what, we're here to have a good time, and I hope you are too, because that's how we do it here. We love worshiping the Lord, and we love having a fun time while we do that. But here's a, boy, this thing goes back to, I don't think I know of an artist that hasn't done this song. That riding,
John the Revelator.
Tell me who's that riding,
John the Revelator.
Tell me who of the seven seals. You know God walked down in the cool of the day, called Adam by his name. He refused to answer, 'cause he was naked and ashamed. Tell me who's that riding,
John.
Christ had 12 apostles, three he laid away. He said, watch with me 1 hour while I go yonder and pray. Tell me who's that riding,
John the Revelator.
Tell me who's that riding,
John the Revelator.
Tell me who's that riding,
John the Revelator.
He wrote the book of the seven seals. Disciples to meet me in Galilee. Tell me who's that riding,
John the Revelator.
Tell me who's that riding,
John the Revelator.
Tell me who's that riding,
John the Revelator.
Wrote the book of the seven seals. Now tell me who's that riding,
John the Revelator.
Tell me who's that riding,
John the Revelator.
Tell me who's that riding,
John the Revelator.
Wrote the book of the seven seals. 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 Oh, yeah. Ooh. Yeah. All right. That was not the Johnny Cash version, by the way. Oh, all right. Well, here's enough. I'll tell you what. I don't get to use this guitar a whole lot. And I'm very thankful for it because it weighs about 150 pounds. So I just as soon as not do any more songs that really require this. You know? All right. Well, sometimes, you know, got to be careful. You got to watch out because Jesus is watching you. And sometimes he's doing things just to get your attention. You know that?
Well, you might be saved, might be reborn, might drive a car with a big loud horn. Maybe it's just news on your television, and it might be God trying to get your attention. You an engineer, gonna pitch that bomb for a Casanova with a whole lot of charm. Might be a mouse living in your kitchen, and it might be God trying to get your attention. Well, it might sound bad,
might sound good,
made of steel, made of wood. Might be news on your television, it might be God trying to get your attention. Well, it might be in the church house, might be in the street, somehow or another every soul has got to meet. Well, it might be in the city, it might be in the town, one way or another you're gonna find that higher ground. Well, you might be deaf,
might be blind,
should put the message right in your mind. Might look like a plan or the coalition, and it might be God trying to get your attention. Oh Lord. You might be deaf,
might be deaf,
you might be dumb,
might be dumb.
You'll get the answer when the answer comes. It might be news on your television, it might be God trying to get your attention. Might be God trying to get your attention. Oh yeah, oh yeah. Listen to the birds, trees.
Listen to the
river.
Listen to the
bees.
Listen to the sea.
Listen to the mountains.
Listen to the mountains.
Listen to the land.
Listen to the land.
Don't listen to the woman.
Listen to the woman.
Listen to the man.
Don't listen to the man.
Listen to the rain.
Listen to the rain.
Listen to the wind.
Listen to the wind.
Listen to your mind.
Listen to your mind.
Then listen all over again.
Woo!
Yeah, listen. You better listen. You better listen, you better listen. I'm telling you, listen, you better listen. You better listen.
Yeah. Well, sorry about all this guitar switching, but every once in a while we have a bunch of songs that we haven't done in a while. We need to do them all together. So I just as soon do them all together and have one Sunday where I'm switching guitars, because they each are kind of a little bit specialized and need a special guitar. So that's what we're doing today. Today is guitar swap day. I'm going to make you carry this song, this steel guitar, yeah. All right. Yeah. Way to put me in my place. That's right. All right.
Overture, curtain lens.
Here you go, Anna.
In the corner where nobody sees is the kid with a story no one would believe. He prays every night, dear God, won't you please, could you send someone here who will love me? Who will love me for me? Not for me. to die as he sits all alone. Here's a man in a cell who regrets what he's done. He utters a cry from the depth of his soul. Oh Lord, forgive me, I wanna go home.
All right. Hey, good morning, everybody. Welcome. Welcome to Happy Hour at the world-famous Salvation Saloon. And for those of you who may just be here for the very first time, we always start our services by letting you guys know that we are so glad you guys are here, and we truly believe God is going to bless you guys today. There is one thing we would ask, though, if you don't mind, and that is if you just grab one of these little yellow cards that you see all over the place. If you would, just throw your name in that. Tell us where you're from. That'd be cool. But then if you don't mind, if you just hold on to this card till the end of the service and write down the bottom in the comment section, tell us what you thought. We're always kind of curious. So if you do that, that would be great. But again, welcome to the Saloon. We're so glad you guys are spending your Sunday mornings with us, and you are our guest. So from here on out, just sit back, hang on, enjoy the ride. Everyone else knows we do have some other purposes for these cards, though, and that is if there happens to be a birthday or an anniversary, it could be just about anything that you think we've got to know about. You can put it on this card 1 week in advance. But the main reason we have these cards is for prayer. So if you're here and you have a need in your life, put that need down on this card and give God an opportunity to show himself strong, because prayer does work. Amen? This is what the Bible tells us. The Bible tells us that our God is a present help in times of trouble, and it also tells us that sometimes we have not because we ask not. So put your needs down on this card. All right, well, here at the Salvation Saloon, we are a family. Like every family, we try to make sure that we recognize each other, and we don't have any anniversaries or birthdays today, but we do have this game that we play each and every week, and that is a game called Name That Saloonatic. Now, if you are here for the first time, just so you do know, we do call our congregation members Saloonatics. And every week what we do is we try to get an old picture, and we throw it up, try to guess who it is. And so see what you can do with this. See if you can tell me who this Saloonatic is. Dave George? Bob? Elvis Presley? John Cougar Mellencamp. Wow, I didn't think I was going to stump you guys today. Will the Rail Saloon take please stand? He's already half standing anyway. Hey, it's Bill Flanagan. All right. All right, got a few announcements here before we move along. I mentioned this last week. When's this taking place? It's not taking place until April 6th, but we have the Kingdom Legacy Live conference coming up. There it is right there. With Tony Evans, Priscilla Shire. That is, again, April 6th. And it's taking place in Lakeland at the Victory Church. We do have some flyers in the back. I mentioned this last week. A lot of you guys, I guess, have already kind of been planning to go, and you've some of you have purchased your tickets. Tickets are going to go fast, so we just encourage you, if you're going to go, be a pretty big group of us going. We'd love to have you join us. Grab one of these on the way out and make sure you get your tickets. Also, Friday, this is coming right up, Friday, March 1st at 6:30 p.m., we're going to have another one of our famous men fellowship dinners, and that's going to be taking place at Diesel's Garage, which is right up the road here. It's 34200 U.S. Highway 19 North, Palm Harbor. There is a sign-up sheet in the on the table on your way out. So again, men's fellowship dinner. Diesel's Garage, March 1st. That's a Friday. So make sure you sign up for that so we have an idea of how many we'll have to make reservations for. And that, I believe, is it. So Billy's going to come up. He's going to pray God's blessing on the remainder of the service, and then we'll get the nitty-gritty church band back up here. Here's Billy.
That was my cowboy jacket. I don't know. That was the pre-fat days, obviously. So today, speaking of fat, just so you know, today is National Healthy Fat Day. I don't know what that means, but I guess we're the healthy fats. So that's what today is. But anyway, it's good to see y'all. And nice to see the few of you that are brave and made it out in the rain, because apparently everybody else is a bunch of wussies. So if you notice someone that's not here, call them up and laugh at them. Tell them they're big scaredy cats. But anyway, so let's get right into it. We got a great message, I'm sure, today, and hopefully we will hear it and then apply it and walk it out in this crazy world that we live in, surrounded by crazy people. So ask at this time if you're going to make a check, make it out to the Salvation Saloon. If you're watching online, salvationsaloon.com, you can click on the Donate Now button right there, and we'll happily set that up for you so you can tithe that way also. So, Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Lord, that we could be in your house this morning, and we just thank you, Lord, for the many blessings that we received throughout the week and throughout our walk with you. Father, we ask that above all that you be glorified in all that happens here today, and that those that have a need, Lord, you know before we can even ask. So, Father, we would ask that you would just show up and show off. And just let everybody know what a powerful daddy we have, and help us to remember to stop telling God how big our problems are, but tell our problems how big our God is. So, Father, we love you, and we give you praise for all that happens. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Well, this is one of those famous buzzy songs that's been around with us for a long time. And I have no idea where he found this song. This song is like a old spiritual that hung around in churches forever. But But they didn't play it this way. Somehow he came up. He came out of the service with this song, didn't he? Came out of his service. But, boy, we just keep playing it because it's a great song and it's just a fun song. You'll recognize it, I'm pretty darn sure.
All right. Well, today we return to our verse-by-verse study of Luke's gospel. And it was in chapter 23 that Jesus had been sentenced to die, and first by the Jewish religious leaders and the judicial body of the Sanhedrin, and then by Rome itself as a Judean governor, Pilate, despite his reluctance, he then turned Jesus over to be crucified. And that's when Jesus was beaten And then he was mocked and ridiculed all the way to the place of the skull, which is also known as Golgotha or Calvary. And that's where Jesus, at about 9 o'clock in the morning, he was nailed to a cross between two criminals. And one of those criminals, became the very first conversion of the new covenant. And man, what a beautiful picture and example of God's grace that was. Amen. But as we pick things up in verse 44, well, it tells us this. Tells us that it was now about noon. So that tells us that Jesus has been on the cross for about 3 hours. And that's when something out of the ordinary takes place. And that is, as Luke tells us, a darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon. Because as it tells us in verse 45, the sun had stopped shining. So, you know, it's kind of like even nature refused to look upon the agony of its creator. Now, to go along with this, here's some pretty cool historical confirmation. Confirmation by the Roman historian Phlegon, who in writing about the crucifixion, well, he said this. He said there was an extraordinary eclipse of the sun at the sixth hour, and since the days back then began at 6 a.m., then just as Luke says here, that darkness fell over the land at noon. In describing this even more, it was Phlegon who said that the day turned into dark night so that even the stars in heaven were seen. And he had stated that there was also an earthquake, which is kind of cool because that is exactly what the other Gospels had said took place at that ninth hour or at 3 o'clock. Now, what I believe is that when that darkness fell over that last three-hour period, that is when, as Isaiah chapter 3 foretold, that is when God had laid on him, on Jesus, the iniquity of us all. Right? And I believe this because of the statement that Jesus made when he was on the cross, told to us in Matthew's gospel. But on the cross, Jesus cried out, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani." Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Now, that's been a rather confusing statement to many a man and scholar, because what's that all about, right? I'm going to tell you what it's all about. It's about sin, right? It's about sin, the sin that the Bible tells us that separates us from God. And so I believe it was at that moment that the sins of the whole world was then placed on the body of Jesus, and a righteous God, he had to turn away. He had to turn away. Because just as it says in Habakkuk chapter 1, it tells us there that the eyes of God are too pure to look upon evil. And so for Jesus, you know, just think about this. For Jesus, who had never been separated from his Father before, you know, I'm thinking this must have been the most painful experience of the whole crucifixion. But it was also a rewarding experience, right? Because that is when Jesus experienced death for all of us, right? And I'm not talking about physical death, but I'm talking about spiritual death, which is defined as being separated from God. But as Jesus bore our sins, well, he then bridged that gap between us and God. And that is when Jesus then said, "It is finished. It is finished." Because that's when the debt of man's sin was then paid in full. Our sin was paid in full. And what's that mean? It means no more animal sacrifices. Right? That yearly slaughter of all those, you know, poor innocent lambs. Because Jesus became the Lamb of God. The Lamb of God. He became the final sacrifice in the final Passover. And so when that happened, at 3 in the afternoon, that is when that earthquake struck. And as it now states, when that earthquake struck, it tells us that the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Now this curtain, let me describe this for you. This is really quite a thing here. It was 60 feet tall, 30 feet wide, and 4 inches thick, right? And it separated man from the room that is known as the Holy of Holies, which is the most sacred area that was within the temple, because that is where the presence of God would dwell. But here's the thing. Since all men have sinned and have fallen short of God's righteous glory, then no man can stand in the presence of God. In fact, as God had stated back in the Old Testament in Leviticus, God said anyone who would enter into this room and into his presence, it would result in instant death. But there was one day. One day every year, the Day of Atonement, where the high priest, and only after undergoing all these specific rituals and cleansing, well, only then could he actually enter in and survive in that the Holy of Holies. And he went in there so that he could then sprinkle the blood of a sacrificial animal, which would make atonement for his sins first and then for the sins of all the people. Now, to show you how serious the Jews took all of this, well, just in case the priest entered and had some unknown blemish and he was in there and he was struck dead, well, knowing that nobody could go in and get him, well, what they would do is they would actually tie a rope or a chain to his leg so that if something did go wrong, then they could just pull him back out. But again, here's the thing with that. It had to be continually repeated year after year after year because this sacrifice, it was only a temporary fix. Only a temporary fix. Since it could never remove sin, but what it did, it just covered sin. It covered sin. Anyways, maybe you've already figured out that this curtain that stood as a barrier between God and us, well, it is representative of the sin that separates all of us from God. But when that sin was taken from us and then was placed on Jesus, right, as we just saw here, then, man, that is when that curtain was split wide open. In fact, this is what Matthew's gospel tells us. Matthew's gospel actually says that it was torn from the top to the bottom. So if you think about that, you know, it's kind of like it was torn from heaven to earth or from God to man, right? And so now, because of the finished work of our Savior Jesus, well, just as the Bible says, we can now come boldly before the throne of grace. Because just as it states in 2 Corinthians 5:21, God made him, Jesus, who had no sin, to be sin for us, so that in him we could attain the righteousness of God. And here's scripture now from Hebrews chapter 10 that just kind of confirms and verifies all of this that I've been saying. As it states there, it says, therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to now enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus through a new and better covenant, which was opened for us through the curtain that is his body, the body that bore our sins. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. And so now, the mission's complete. Now the mission is complete. And so with that mission completed, verse 46 tells us that Jesus then called out with a loud voice, and he said, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. And according to John's gospel, well, he also affirms at that time, he affirms and declares, it is finished. It is finished. And when he had said this, that is when he breathed his last. All right, so picture all of this, right? You've got this beaten and bloody man on the cross, right, who's been mocked and tortured, and yet people are hearing him praying for all those who had taken part in all of that, right? And he's even heard, while he's up there on the cross, he's even heard pleading for their forgiveness, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they've done, right? And then you've got all this strange darkness that's fallen over the earth, right, along with the shaking and the rumbling of a sudden earthquake. And that's when, as it says in verse 47, that's when the centurion, right? The Roman soldier who was overseeing this execution. Well, seeing all that had happened, well, this is what he does. He praises God. And he says, surely this was a righteous man. Or as Mark's gospel puts it, surely this was the Son of God. Surely this was the Son of God. Now, some of you may have seen this movie, but John Wayne actually played that centurion role in one of the early movies about Jesus. But wouldn't it be cool to actually know that he also made that confession in his own life? All right, here's a story for you. John Wayne was an acquaintance of the Reverend Robert Schuller. Some of you guys may be familiar with him. Remember, he used to have that TV show. He was the guy with the Crystal Cathedral. John Wayne heard that Schuller's daughter, Carol, had lost her leg in a motorcycle accident. And so being concerned, what he did is he sent her a note that said this. It's sorry to hear about your accident. I hope you'll be all right. Signed, John Wayne. Well, she decided to write him back, and this is what she said. She said, thanks for writing me, and I will be all right because Jesus is helping me. But then she writes this. She said, Mr. Wayne, do you know Jesus? I hope so, because I can't imagine heaven being complete without John Wayne. I hope you give your heart to Jesus, and I hope to see you in heaven. Signed, Carol Schuller. Now, just as she finished writing this, a visitor came to see her, and she told him about the letter she had just written to John Wayne. And the visitor said that he just happened to be going to a country club dinner that night in which John Wayne was supposed to attend. Right? Kind of a timely coincidence, right? Anyways, guy said, you know, give me the letter and I'll hand deliver it to John Wayne. So that night, he goes to the dinner, he hands it to John Wayne, and John Wayne he took it and he opened it up right there and he started reading it. But as he did, as he was reading it, people started to notice that John Wayne was crying. And of course, they all asked him, you know, what was wrong? And John Wayne, not being shy, he got up and he shared the letter with everyone that was there. And then he pointed to the guy who had, you know, delivered him that letter. And this is what he said. He said, you tell that little girl that right now, in this restaurant, John Wayne just gave his heart to Jesus, and she will see me in heaven. You know what? 3 weeks later, John Wayne died. 3 weeks later. And again, I love stories like this because, again, it just tells us, just confirms to us, our labors are never in vain, people. Our labors are never in vain. Anyways, I love that story. But back to this story, here's a centurion, right? He makes that public confession of his faith. And in verse 48, it tells us this, tells us that when all the people who had gathered to witness his sight saw what took place, they beat their breasts and went away. Now, some of them were happy, right? They were happy to see that Jesus was finally out of the way, while others were sad because the Messiah that they believed was going to establish his kingdom on the earth, well, that Messiah was now dead along with all their hopes and dreams. And in verse 49, all those who knew him, including the women who had followed him from Galilee, well, they stood at a distance watching these things. And I can just imagine that, you know, they're just trying to kind of make some sense of all this. But now it tells us this in verse 50. It says, there was a man named Joseph, a member of the council. All right, what's that council? Well, actually, this guy was a member of that Sanhedrin, right? Which was that group of judges that had just found Jesus to be guilty of blasphemy. But as for this Sanhedrin council member, well, it tells us here that he was a good and upright man. He was a good and upright man who, in verse 51, had not consented to their decision and action. So he had opposed their guilty verdict and their death sentence. And then it says that, tells us a little bit about him, tells us that he came from the Judean town of Arimathea, and he himself was waiting for the kingdom of God. So obviously that tells us he was a believer, But because of his position in life, that was something that he probably kept on the down low, I'm kind of thinking. But as it now tells us in verse 52, it says, going to Pilate, he asked for Jesus' body. Now, in John's gospel, it says that he was also accompanied by someone else. It tells us he was accompanied by a man named Nicodemus, which I think we're kind of familiar with. If not, Nicodemus, he was a Pharisee, and he had earlier secretly visited Jesus at night, and the story of that's in John chapter 3. And he is the one that Jesus had told that he must be born again. And since we see him now here with this Joseph, it appears that he had taken his advice. But what these guys are doing here, it will no doubt reflect badly in respect to their highly regarded positions and their reputations. Now, how all of that played out is not known for sure. I mean, the Bible has no further information regarding these two guys. But there are some sources outside of the Bible that actually suggested that Nicodemus lost his position as a Pharisee, and he was later banished from Jerusalem. And so it is likely, very likely, that he did pay a price for his loyalty and his faith. But this I can guarantee you of, and that is he had no regrets. He had no regrets, because just as it states in Romans 8:18, our suffering, our present sufferings, are not even worth comparing, right, with the glory that will one day be revealed in us. Amen? Right, because here's the deal. There is one life to live, and it will soon be passed. Only what's done for Christ will last. Anyways, they're granted position, permission to take the body. And in verse 53, they took it down, took Jesus down from the cross. They wrapped his body in linen cloth, and they placed it in a tomb cut in rock, one of which no one had been laid. Now, a little bit of information about this Joseph. He was a very wealthy man, very wealthy man. Matthew tells us that this tomb was actually his own personal tomb that he had purchased for his own use. So Jesus obviously meant a lot to him, right? Because at the time, I mean, he obviously had no idea that Jesus was only going to need it for a couple days, right? But so that worked out pretty good. But anyways, all of this is telling us this for a reason, telling us this because this actually fulfilled prophecy as well. Prophecy that said that the Messiah would be killed with the wicked and would be buried with the rich. And now, as it states in verse 54, says it was now preparation day. So it's time now to prepare the body of Jesus for burial. But, as it says, the Sabbath was about to begin, which means they did not have the time to prepare the body like they had wanted to. But in verse 55, the women who had come with Jesus from Galilee, they followed Joseph and saw the tomb and how his body was laid in it. So they saw where Jesus was buried. And of course, that's usually where the story ends, right? But as for this story, just let you guys know, we got another chapter, okay? But as this one concludes, this chapter concludes, in verse 56, we're told that the women, then went home and prepared spices and perfumes, right, so that they could return and prepare the body properly. But first, they rested on the Sabbath in obedience to the commandment. Now, while they were waiting for the Sabbath to end, it's in Matthew's gospel that it tells us that the chief priest then went to Pilate, and they asked Pilate to make sure that he had the tomb guarded, because they had remembered what Jesus had said, right? Remember that Jesus said that, you know, after 3 days I will rise again. And so they were kind of thinking that that his disciples might very well try to steal his body, and then they would create this big hoax. Anyways, Pilate, he does order the tomb to be guarded, or at least give it your best shot, boys. And we'll see how all of that plays out when we pick things up next time in chapter 24, which will be the last chapter of the Gospel of Luke. And so next time we're going to see, it'll start out, we'll see the women will return to the tomb, and we'll see, you know, what they find or what they won't find. But right now, here's Jason, and he's going to come up and close in prayer. And love you guys. See you next week.
Good morning, y'all. How are you doing? You may notice it's a little quiet. We don't have a little girl hollering out random words throughout our service. Not that they aren't great additions, don't get me wrong. Angela and the kids left yesterday. They went up to Maine for 3 weeks, so they'll be back. And they're bringing my mom when they come back, so it'll be good, yeah. Yeah. So, this thing's just not working for me today. Okay, we're in business. So, Friday, we had a day off, so I've been trying to get over to the Titanic Museum. Eli is fascinated with that. I think it was our fourth attempt. We always get interrupted somehow, either on the way or maybe a little guy was acting up a little bit, and we're like, no, we're not doing this today. But we never made it there. Now, it reminded me of a story about the Titanic, if you don't mind indulging me for a couple minutes. They didn't touch on it on the museum, unfortunately. There was a passenger, John Harper. I don't know if any of you guys have heard of Reverend John Harper. He preached in England. He went on a mission, went to Chicago for a couple of weeks, went to New York for a couple of weeks, went back to England, and then the Moody Church in New York had an opening, and they're like, we loved this guy. We need you to come back. And he agreed. He was a widower, so his sister and his daughter, and he they got three tickets on the Titanic, so you can fill in your adjective there, whether they were fortunate enough or not. But he was an amazing man. The boat was going down, and he got his daughter and his sister on the boat, and then decided he didn't have to go. Instead, he stood on the deck and preached and saved people until he could no longer stand on the deck. And he jumped in the water and he swam to the closest person and said, do you know Jesus? Do you want to be saved? Now, the water was about 28 degrees. He didn't have a lot of opportunity, but after he'd done with that person, he swam to the next closest person, said, do you know Jesus? And then the next closest person until he took off his life vest and said, you need this more than I do. Amazing. Now, relevance. Why is that relevant? Well, I dare say that as we look around our world and our nation, we're going down, folks. We are going down, and it's, I don't know if it'll be cold, it'll probably be hot, but it might be time to say, hey, this might be your last chance, much like the little girl with John Wayne. Do you know Jesus? Swim to your fellow man and just ask. It's a simple question. It can be an uncomfortable question, but it's a simple question. If you don't mind, we'll go to the throne, and I'll let you guys go. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for getting my precious family up north safe, and please bring them back safely. Thank you for the words that Paul taught. It's always good to get fed from the word. It's amazing what you did. I couldn't imagine having been separated from your father like that on the cross after a millennia of being together. It's just unimaginable. It's something I can't wrap my human brain around. Please help us grow closer to you. Help us understand you. Help us keep our eyes on you and do the work that you want us to do. And bring us back next week. Let us learn more. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks a lot, guys. Have a good week. If you can clean up, please do.